Good evening. I'm Peter Troughton, Pro-Chancellor. It's my delight to introduce our Founders' Day lecturers. 50-50 towards a diverse and sustainable future. Our speakers, Dawn and Peter Bonfield, met while studying here at Bath. When Peter was awarded... gets better. When Peter was awarded an honorary doctorate in 2011, the orator, Professor Tim Ibell, noted that Peter's era at Bath had spawned lifelong love affairs. And he wrote, first with sustainability and Dawn. Dawn is the chief executive of the Women's Engineering Society, which for the last 96 years has been promoting and enabling more women to work in engineering careers. The university is a keen supporter and has its own Student Women's Engineering Society, affiliated to WES. Peter is the chief executive of the Building Research Establishment. I know he has a badge to remind him. He was part of the Olympic Delivery Authority, where he co-developed and delivered the sustainability strategy for the London 2012 Olympics. He has also been appointed by HM Government to chair three independent reviews on the topics of UK forestry, food and farming, and currently UK housing energy efficiency and renewable technologies. Peter was awarded an OBE for services to research and innovation in the construction industry in the Queen's Birthday Honours in June 2012. The Vice-Chancellor is going to deal with the questions afterwards, but I've reassured her you will deal with the answers. We look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Thank you. Thanks. Come on.
Thank you very much, Pro-Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen. It's fantastic to be back here in Bath University. We had an amazing time here, so it's great to be back here with all our friends. Thank you for inviting us this evening. So we're looking forward to telling you more about diversity. That's from our own perspectives. And
part of the way we're going to do that is we're going to look back and consider three challenges that the country has faced where diversity has played a key role.
Yeah, then we're going to bring it forward to tell you about what we do today. So, as you heard, I work for the Women's Engineering Society. Mine is more about gender diversity. Pete will tell you more about thought diversity, and he is from the Building Research Establishment.
And then we'll finish with some thoughts which I hope you can take away and find helpful in pushing diversity, both in gender and in thinking, from this evening. So, Dawn, let's go back to the Second World War.
First
World War, even.
So, I'm going to tell you first, my bit's the first part, and I'm going to tell you more about how the Women's Engineering Society started. So, we're a charity today, and we set up in 1919, and women had worked in engineering during the First World War, really for the very first time in many, many cases. About 1.5 million women worked in these professions, and the government spent about £30 million training them to become engineers at that time. They worked in all types of industries, from the war effort, making munitions, armaments, aircraft wings, right through to the very highly skilled roles, polishing radar equipment. And they worked on the home effort as well, so they were making motor cars, in construction, so everything that needed doing, basically. And at that time, it was in the paper today, actually, in the Times. There was a clip from 100 years ago of the Times, and it was an appeal, really, to the manufacturers to say, listen, you know, you've got factories that are sitting idle, equipment that's not being used. You need to go out there and encourage women to start working in these industries. And that's exactly what they did. But what they did have to do, and the thing that was quite startling, was that they said, you've got to make every effort. So whatever it takes, you've got to make every effort to get them involved. So what they did was they built their factories outside of the main city centres so that children who had to come in with these women could let their children play outside. The shift patterns that they arranged were made around the children's educational needs, and they often had a creche on site. And we've got some amazing pictures of women who sit round in the factory kind of canteen with flowers on the table, having tea, and they all stop for tea. And they really wanted to make these factories a real home from home. So at the end of the First World War, there was an act passed called the Restoration of Pre-War Practices, which meant that men could come back into the jobs that they'd left when they went away. And that meant that women then couldn't continue in these roles. But by that time, they'd really enjoyed doing them. You know, they were very very suited to the roles because they'd been used to working to being in the home where they were good at organisational skills. And they brought those skills into the factories and made a lot of efficiencies and made the production line run more smoothly. And they were good, very good with manual dexterity as well. So, you know, these were roles that really suited them. And then because we'd had women had got the vote in 1918 for the first time and the suffrage movement was very strong, these women for the first time were then really inspired to group together, really, and they formed the Women's Engineering Society. And it was quite the women involved were the women who at that time were very influential. So it was two women from the Parsons family. So Sir Charles Parsons, the shipbuilder, it was his wife, Lady Catherine Parsons, and their daughter. And Lady Shelley Rolls, who was the sister of Charles Rolls. So these were women from engineering families. So they set up the Women's Engineering Society in 1919. One of the things they had at the time that was really important was the journal, The Woman Engineer. And that was a place where women could get their scientific and technical work published for the first time. They couldn't be members of professional institutions. They couldn't get qualifications, degrees in engineering. So they organised themselves through this journal. And one thing I will say, we've just had this journal digitised. It goes back to 1919. It's in the IET, the Institution of Engineering and Technology Archive. And it's coming online later this year. And when it does, I encourage you to have a look because it's a really fascinating history of women in the UK, really, and in society in general. So that's the end of my first bit.
And then I'm going to move you forward just a little bit, quite a few years later, about the 1960s, 50s, 60s, post-war, industrial might growing around Britain, and especially in Bristol. There was all sorts of manufacturing, aircraft, all sorts of engineering things going on, and there was a real lack of or need to train more and more skilled engineers and technicians in the West Country, and Bristol got a bit full up. So somehow or other a land deal was done for a peppercorn rent at Claverton Down, and this building was built. This is South Building, which is still in existence. I think there's biology and stuff that goes on there now, but the preliminary building was established here, and in 1966, I think, was it the 26th of October? 25th of October, 1966, the college got its royal charter and became the University of Bath. And about the same time, too, there were things going on with women and engineering and technology as well, weren't there, Dawn?
Yeah, there were. Around the 50s and 60s, the Women's Engineering Society set up something called the Electrical Association for Women. And the idea behind that was to get women to use electricity in the home, so that they could come out of the homes again. I mean, this had happened, you know, the First World War brought them into the workplace and so did the Second World War. But even in the 50s, they were still really not strong in the workplace. So when electricity came along, this institution's aim was to try and get women to use electricity and not be frightened of it so that they could reduce the time that they spent on washing clothes and, you know, keeping the house clean. So they had these tea towels made and dusters and and dusters and pinnies. And, you know, we've got them still today, and these are in the archive as well. We've just had these images digitised, and we're going to try and get them printed so that we can maybe sell them again, because they're quite retro. But actually, they were, you know, for the time, telling people how to wire a plug, you know, what fuse their equipment used, and how much electricity each of their piece of equipment was going to take was, you know, one way of actually reaching these women. And it did have the desired effect and get these women into the workplace. So that was a real change in our society, if you like, brought about by this type of campaign.
So I know Naomi is here from the IET, the President of the Institute of Engineering Technology. We need these things, but for wireless now, or how to make your computer work, wasn't it? Yeah. Anyway, I'm going to bring us forward a little bit further, and I'm going to talk about this work I did on the Olympics. I can get this up and running. So 2006, against every expectation, we'd won the right to host the Olympic Games. And as the Pro-Chancellor said, I was seconded part-time to lead on sustainability for the Olympics. It was a very unlikely win for us. We didn't expect to win in London. And one of the ways that we won was by pitching the greenest games ever. And my job, with others, was to develop a strategy for that with some clear targets in that allowed us to demonstrably build the greenest games ever. And I want to give a different slant on diversity here, because to build this project, if you remember, first of all, our track record for building things in Britain on big infrastructure projects wasn't that brilliant. We were used to being late, to there being all sorts of litigation, going over budget and things like that. And the other real issue for all Olympic Games is, apart from actually in London, there hasn't been an Olympic Games where somebody hasn't died in the construction process. So the diverse thinking we brought, when I joined the team right in the beginning of 2006, just after David Higgins, who was our CEO, was appointed, he said, right, we've got this diverse system we're going to deliver against. And it's a very unlikely system, but we've got to work out a way of doing this. And our diverse system is, the first thing is, on our project, everybody goes home every night uninjured and alive. We want to be the first Olympic Games without a major injury and without any deaths. The second thing is, we can't be late. Clearly, we can't be late for the Olympics. Third thing is, although we seem to have a very big budget, you know, we couldn't go over budget, and it was very difficult to do that. The fourth thing is, we're going to make all the green targets that we set. That was my accountability to make sure we delivered that. And the fifth thing is, we can avoid the normal thing of litigation and fallout. So that's a very different way of thinking about a project. Normally, you have military-like rules and regulations about how things are procured, how they're specified, the roles of engineers and others. But we knew to deliver on our project, the only way we could deliver those outcomes was by adopting a completely different culture, where rather than prescribing the answers right through the many tens of thousands of people that work with us, we had to develop a culture where people understood our top-level diverse system and found ways of innovating to deliver against it. And of course, if you think about the outcome was nobody died and we had no serious injuries on that project. We came in a year early with the Aquatic Centre, which was an engineering marvel to design and a constructor's nightmare to build. We came in well under our budget, which seemed quite a lot, but wasn't, especially when every pound seemed to be signed off by the Chancellor of the Exchequer at the time. And we avoided all litigation, and we met or exceeded all the green and sustainability targets, which was a pretty remarkable outcome. And now the thing in Britain is, you know, if you think about Crossrail or High Speed 2 or Tideway Tunnel, we have an expectation in our industry, and the public have an expectation that we'll deliver with excellence. And that was born on the Games because of this diverse way of thinking and this culture of allowing innovation and good things to happen. This was a diverse system. So these were the key priorities in the sustainability strategy. And you'll note the top ones, which you'd expect, around energy or carbon, water, waste, and those sorts of things, materials too. But actually, what was most important for us on our sustainability strategy were actually societal impacts, because we knew in that part of London life expectancy was 7 years longer, 7 years less than in Westminster. There was a lot of depression, a lot of people who didn't have jobs, a lot of obesity, all sorts of societal problems in that area. And in fact, the main goal of our project wasn't to deliver, you know, zero waste and these other things. It was actually to create a place that worked for Londoners in that area, that created a healthier society and places where people were proud of. And in fact, a whole part of that was thinking about how you actually, how you control house prices and things like that to allow the people that were there to stay there. So a key part of that too was thinking about jobs and employment and how we'd create places where people could work. So again, that was a very diverse and different way of thinking about sustainability. We used other schemes as well. One of the other things we thought about, there's this cradle-to-cradle philosophy, which is sort of one ecosystem's waste is another ecosystem's nutrients. So rather than doing the normal thing with the 220 buildings on the park, which is to demolish them, take them off site in loads of trucks, and then bring in clean stuff, we decided that waste, that old waste, was actually the nutrient for the park. So 99% of all the buildings and all the stuff that was on the park stayed on the park and we reused it. And that's why in the video clip you saw, for about the first 2 or 3 years, the site was just covered in piles of brown or grey stuff that was different grades, which was all these buildings ground up that were gradually used to clean up the soils and provide all the substructures to support all the venues. And in fact, that was, for all you civil engineers in here, I can tell you that was the most innovative, outstanding achievement on the projects. For all you structural engineers, actually building the venues apart from the aquatic centre was a piece of cake. We used BREEAM, BRE Environmental Assessment Method, I'm going to talk about a little bit later, but this is another diverse way of thinking about designing green homes. The point about this is it brings together the main factors that you need to think about when you're delivering a green building, and it brings together different science, so the way you model and calculate performance in these different areas is quite different. But this brings them together into a diverse system where the design teams, the engineers, the materials providers and others can innovate to come up with the optimal outcome. So you can balance your outcome depending on what type of building you're looking for. So for example, the aquatic centre is a very heavy concrete structure with loads of thermal mass that's very good for keeping swimming pools hot once you put energy into them. Whereas the velodrome is a very lightweight structure, very quick and safe to build, and very easy, in fact, to regulate the temperature of, to make sure that you get world record times at the right temperature on the track level. And in fact, if you look at the side of this, there are two key innovations here, both of which came from contractors, actually. The first was like a trampoline roof. So rather than having very big, deep beams, we actually had a cable structure, 2 metre squares, with very lightweight wood panels in each, which were fabricated on the ground, levered up, put in place, so it is like a great big trampoline. That takes a load of load off the substructure and superstructure. So that was one innovation. The other innovation was this has got about a third the normal mechanical ventilation load you'd expect in a building because it uses passive ventilation, which comes from these slots in the side. And indeed, even if you look under your seats, if you ever have the joy of going and watching cycling there, you'll see even the tiers that support your seats have got slots in to encourage airflow. So very, very innovative. The other thing on diversity was, you know, when you're trying to deliver sustainability and you've got about 15,000 people on the site, most of whom have been around the block for many years and know how to do it and aren't the politest chaps, mostly. How do you get them all to change their behaviours? Well, we deployed about 40 environmental managers to each of the main sites to work with all the contractors. And what was really interesting on their personal characteristics, first thing is 80% of them were women. So is that 37 out of 40? That's about 80%, isn't it? My maths isn't very good, sorry. Former lecturers. Anyway, most were women, and their age was between 22 and 32. Completely out of place on a construction site, but absolutely brilliant at coaxing all these chaps to behave in the ways that were different and they needed to do. And now, indeed, a lot of the environmental managers, those women, have gone on and they're running their own consulting businesses, or they have really good roles now in the likes of Atkins and Arrows, because they've found a way of thinking in a diverse way that us older chaps struggle with. We also bought against a balanced scorecard of factors. I'm going to talk more about that. And equalities and diversity, which you see here on this line, we only employed companies who managed their people well and managed their businesses well. And you think, well, why would you do that? That costs more. But you know what those people do for you on a construction project, which was rare? If they're well managed, if they care about their people, they actually do what they say they're going to do when they say they're going to do it at the cost they're going to do it for. And that was one of the ways in which we got the project done, by only employing responsible companies onto our site. Now, Wes. So there's some three challenges. We're now going to go on to a bit about what Dawn and I do in our respective roles now.
So I said before how the Women's Engineering set up in 1919. You know, you might be thinking, well, that was a long time ago. It's 2016 now. What are you still doing here today? Well, we're still here today because the number, if you work in engineering, you probably know the figures. The numbers of women in engineering in the UK is very low. We're this one down here. We're the worst in Europe. We're about 7 or 8% qualified women engineers working in the profession. We're down to 4% sometimes in construction apprentices. No, well, 1% in construction apprentices. So, you know, we really do still have our work cut out. And some of the reasons why we want more women in engineering, well, one of them is we have a big skill shortage. So we know that we need to double the number of graduates, apprentices and technicians in the next 10 years to make the number that we have predicted that we'll need. So if we can encourage more girls to think about an engineering career, then we're much more likely to reach that target. And that's really actually very helpful because, you know, our organisation has been saying for a long time we need to encourage more women into engineering. But the fact now that we have a skill shortage has meant that lots of the engineering companies have now started to realise that that is the case. And so that's really, I think, I hope, will change the outcomes. Pete has deftly moved on past the slide that he doesn't like, so probably, did you?
No, no, I haven't, no.
Oh, okay. No, we just took
no,
it out.
No, skill shortage, that's the first point.
So the skill shortage is the first thing. The next thing is about diversity. I mean, we're talking all this evening about why we want diversity, but, you know, we have evidence now that tells us that diverse teams are more profitable, more productive, more balanced, better innovation, better creativity, and we want that diversity of thought that we can get from a mixture of people, really, and that includes gender diversity and all of the other underrepresented groups as well. So that's pretty obvious, I think, you know, why we want balanced teams. The third one for me, I think, is the most important, which is equality of opportunity for young people. You know, I think we have for such a long time pushed children, young people, into careers based on their gender rather than on what jobs might suit them or what they're like as people. And it's equally true of boys going into the caring professions and the languages and arts as it is for girls going into engineering. And it's something that we need to stop doing, really, because, you know, we want the mix in every occupation. We as a charity have people come to us all the time, and a school that was 125 years old came to us recently and said they'd never had one girl in 125 years go into engineering. And it was only because one of the dads, who was an engineer, had said, well, you know, when are you going to do the engineering careers talk? And they said, well, we never do that. You know, why would we do that? You know, these are girls, so why would we encourage them to go into engineering? So we're not giving equality of choice. And we've got girls in lower paid careers, and the equality and the pay gap is, you know, unacceptably high. And that's because we're encouraging girls into one profession and boys into another. And engineering is a well-paid career with great opportunities. So, you know, we are not giving that equality of choice to our young people. So we as an organisation, we have a number of ways that we address this. We do things. We see it a little bit as like a hurdles race where, you know, your children start at an early age and then every, you know, sector of their career is like a hurdle that they have to get over. So what we've done is produce some kind of service or product for every one of these hurdles. But given that we're a small organisation, it spreads us pretty thin, actually. But in the education side, we have careers advice, obviously, in literature. One of the things that we do as a women's organisation is we try to have careers advice that is targeted at girls. And I think that's really important, that things don't need to be gender neutral. I think it's like marketing any product. You have to market it in a way that the people that you want to buy the product recognise. So you can't have one campaign that fits all, really. There's some research from the Institution of Mechanical Engineers about tribes. And they call the girls that go into engineering naturally the STEM devotees. And what they say is that they will go into engineering or applied science, whatever you do. So even, you know, without you having to try too hard, they will go into that career sector just because they're that way inclined, or they have a parent who's a scientist or an engineer, or a school who's very supportive. So you almost don't need to do very much for that group. But it's the next group down, which is called the social artists. And they're the type of girls that are good at any subject. So, you know, really they could go any way. So it's that group there that you need to target more, really. And we, you know, it's very difficult to get companies to recognise that it's okay to do that. But we can do that. I mean, we're the Women's Engineering Society, so we're kind of expected or allowed to do that. So our marketing stuff is, it's targeted at girls, really. So we also have this initiative here, which is called Sparks, which what that tries to do is, what we say is there's a lot of outreach out there that lights the spark. So there's a lot of, you know, outreach activities in school, the Big Bang, when we have one of our own Magnificent Women is something that we take into schools. So you go into a school and you light the spark one day, but if you do an activity for a boy and a girl, the boy has much more chance of that being successful than the girl, because if he goes home at the end of the day and says to his parents, "Oh, we had a great outreach activity today and I'd like to be an engineer," well, great. You know, the parents, they kind of jump on that because it's a normal career for a boy. So they will encourage the boy and they'll tell the next door neighbour that, "Oh, yeah, he said he'd like to be an engineer. Wouldn't you like to be an engineer?" And then before you know it, that boy is kind of pushed into engineering. But for a girl, it's very different. And she can go home and say she's had a great activity and it's to do with engineering. And you'll find that she has hurdles put in her way rather than an open path. So what Sparks does is it tries to provide a kind of a nudge for those girls who don't have that support, maybe from home or from school, where we have a kind of continual contact with them to reinforce the message that it is for you and, you know, it is a good career for a girl and it's not unusual and we're here to support you. So it's like, you light the spark, but you have to give it some oxygen. So this is the mechanism for giving that oxygen. So what we do for students, that's the next kind of block that we hope, or we think needs support. I mean, we have, if you've managed to encourage young people, women, into an engineering qualification, the last thing you want them to do is not continue. I mean, if we had enough, then of course that's fine. You know, people would be great if we had a big throughput of women engineers that could go anywhere and everywhere. But because we have so few, we'd like to keep them in engineering. So we have a student conference for women engineers once a year, and we have student groups like the Uni-Bath group here. Now this is our most active group. It was set up a few years ago with the help of Roger and Sue Horrod. They do an amazing job of supporting their students. The students support the next generation. They support the girls that come around to have a look at the university. They've got a great role of helping themselves, helping others, supporting one another, and hopefully staying in the sector. I've had some meetings this afternoon about mentoring, how we can get these girls mentored, how we can make sure that they have work experience placements that allows them to continue in this profession. So that's the student work. For women returners, that's another kind of sticking point, really. Something like the statistics say something like 57% of women on the professional register drop off the register under the age of 45 compared to 17% of men. So, you know, we're losing a huge number of our women at that time where they take maternity breaks. And that's my story as well. That's what happened to me. I came out of the engineering sector when we had our children and never went back in. So, you know, it's a massive resource there that we are not keeping hold of. So what we're doing there is we're trying to set up things called returnships, which are a bit like internships. So anybody that offers an internship, we're trying to encourage them to also add on a returnship, which is for women to come back into so that they have that stepping stone back from a career break. And I'm not talking about the statutory maternity break of a year because, you know, they go back into their profession after that. I'm talking about the ones that come out of engineering for 3 or 4 or 5 years maybe. So we're trying to get these returnships set up so that they can come back into these careers. We have mentoring as well, a mentoring service. And we also have, it's moved on because we've got National Women Engineering Day. And that's something that we set up in 2014 when it was our 95th anniversary. It's a bit like International Women's Day, which was yesterday. So this is a one-day awareness campaign, 23rd of June every year. And what we do is we just try and encourage schools, organisations, individuals, girl guides, anyone and everyone to do something on that day to focus attention on the role of women in engineering. So last year we had about 350 events around the country. thousands and thousands of girls were reached. Companies, they do things for their own women engineers, or they invite students in. We had a world record at Horse Guards Parade where we had 800 women getting a high five world record. That was amazing. So that's a really, really good day, and that's been really successful. And then the idea of that is, once you've raised that awareness on one day of the year, then hopefully you can do something beyond that to keep their interest. That's me done.
Okay, great. Let me. So I want to move on a bit further to Bath, just by way of it. Yeah, we have our well-adored Vice-Chancellor in the bottom left-hand corner, you will note. when you look here, which one's South Building's off down that way, I think. I can't see very well from here. Or, no, is it down here? There it is. Anyway, the point is, go forward a bit, go on Google now, and the university is enormous. And since 1966, not only has the university here developed a great scientific and engineering pedigree and activity, but also, thanks to some very pioneering and ambitious heads of sport here, they found ways to win all sorts of funding for sports scholarships and outstanding sports facilities. And then we've got business and social science and all sorts of other things around. So really, you know, the university has, without doubt, flourished from 1966 to now. 50 years is not actually that long to have achieved the array of outcomes there. And, of course, you've got a gold. Is that Lizzie, who won the gold medal in the Olympics? Yeah. And all sorts of outstanding research work done, and a great vibe reflected back in getting top marks in the student satisfaction survey, I think, for at least 2 years. Is it currently? The last two, anyway.
Sadly, not currently.
Not currently. Anyway, it's just, and we had a great time, didn't we? Before the rankings even started, before they worried about all these KPIs. It's a fantastic place to come, and it's clearly just gone from strength to strength. And there's more and more building, and it's just got this vibrant feel about it. And then you might not recognise a number of these figures in the second row, because this was about 30 years ago. So this is in 1987. There's Brian Harris there. Well, put your hand up, please, Brian. That's the 30-year-old version of Brian Harris. There's Vic. Hand up, Vic. At the back, but at the front today, David Packham. You're there. Martin Ansell, you're on there somewhere as well. There they are. Anyway, so there, that's the class of 1987, but I want to draw your attention to the good-looking girl in white, one in from that side at the back, a certain Dawn, and I'm the postgrad in the yellow shirt, two ahead of her, hoping she might notice me. Anyway, not only was she a fantastic-looking girl on our course doing material science, but also, if I can get this to work,
Oh, that's a shame.
No, we can get this one. Oh, there it is. So the other thing, we were very keen sports people. So this was 1987, thanks to Lizzie Richmond, our archivist here. If it was now, it'd have all music with it. This is actually me riding around a corner, a prize for anybody that can tell me where that corner is on site. So that's me in 1987, all I did was cycling. And who is the best all-round sportsman of the year? This gorgeous Dawn, who was a brilliant netballer, playing international netball. Note her haircut. That was very trendy in those days. And great volleyballer. Anyway, one of the most important outcomes that the university has made in its last 30 years are these three. These are our kids. This is in Christmas time. So there's Jack, Megan and Joe. Jack's actually doing materials. Good lad at Swansea. Started in October. Joe's doing drama at Birmingham, and Megan's doing A-level, split between sciencey things and art. She's one of those, whatever you call them, that hasn't...
Social
artist. Yeah, so she's a social artist. Anyway, so, the university has done really, really well, and we're rather pleased with the one particular set of three outcomes, aren't we? So we have a lot to offer. Now, let's talk about BRE and what we're doing. So a little bit about our history. We started in 1921. We were set up actually after the First World War to look at homes for heroes, because a lot of our people came back from the war, and even though the men could go and take the women's jobs because the law allowed it, as we've heard from Dawn, The quality of housing they came back to was not as it should be, all sorts of energy inefficiency, actually, and poor quality homes. And the problem the government had was, how do they regulate that industry to do things better? And they needed independent, multidisciplinary, diverse research to support that. Anyway, we've carried on. So since 1921, we were actually privatised by Michael Heseltine on the last day of the previous Tory government on the 1997. We're now charitably owned, and we're an organisation that do multidisciplinary research that is brought into a range of tools, products and standards which make the built environment better. About 1,000 people, main site near Watford, 60 acres, where we do all sorts of breaking and blowing up and setting fire to things, all sorts of modelling, and also spreading out in some other places now too. The other thing we've done is, because we're not part of government and because the government seems to be progressively reneging on its commitment to world funding world-leading science and engineering in our country, especially if you're doing applied stuff like we are, we needed to find another way of drawing through science and research. So we established a few years ago a number of university centres of excellence, in one of which is in Bath. So collectively there we've got about 110 students, I think, at the moment, in fact a few more than that. We've done quite a lot of funding now, about £25 million worth of science and research. And what we do is we pull through and we apply the science that our university centres do. And it's a really good model because, you know, we're charitably owned, we don't make lots of profit. But what we do is we'll put a few PhDs into these each year, fund them well, we'll fund a professor and a chair, and we'll locate in universities where the vice-chancellor and the other bosses have got some get-up-and-go and want to grow. And then we'll feed it with all sorts of industrial and entrepreneurial energy and grow things. So although we only fund six chairs, we have actually more. We have about 60 staff now working in that huge programme and some really outstanding outcomes. And I can say that because in that brutal competition that's a research excellence framework, our department at Cardiff, which is focused on civil engineering, beat Imperial. It came number one. And actually, if you look, you know, there are three categories. You'll know, and by the way, you know every university is the best at something, aren't they? If you forget that bit and you just look at the three key scores, Cardiff were number one and beat Imperial at civil engineering because they were below on the grants bit and the peer-reviewed papers bit, but on impact they scored 100%. Our brilliant Tim Eyeball, now Peter Walker-led built environment architecture department here. Where were they ranked in the ref? They were ranked number one. Who did they beat? Cambridge. What did they score on impact? 95%. Now, I think we're just getting going for the last ref. I can't wait for the next one because Bath are going to get 110% impact. Anyway, so we found a really good synergy with universities where we want the science because we can deploy it, I can employ my people, we can make impact with it. And universities need the impact and we can connect the two together. And that's been a really good experiment. Oh, here's Peter. Where's Peter? He's here tonight, isn't he? Yeah. Oh, there he is at the back. Anyway, Peter's done really well and gone from being somebody nobody really noticed very much to being our brilliant professor to being now an outstanding leader of our... Sorry to embarrass you, Peter. It's very uncomfortable. But he's done really, really well. Very distinctive applied work and a great team in the department doing super things. Now, diversity is really important for us in the built environment as well. In fact, it feels like we've been practicing for about 90 years for today because so much is changing so fast. You know, we've got the getting here this morning was a challenge and the climate is changing a lot. It's getting hotter, colder, windier, wetter, all sorts of problems around that. How do we cope with that with our infrastructure and built environment? We're aging very rapidly. And in fact, our health system is bust. As a sickness treatment system, which it really is, isn't it? How quickly and how cheaply can you treat people to get them out and back in their homes? What we've got to think about is how you create healthy communities and healthy societies and healthy people. Be health-oriented more than sickness treatment-oriented. That's a massive challenge for us. Life expectancy growing all the time. By 2050, half our population will be over 65. How on the earth do we deal with that? The answer is you think about diverse ways of dealing with the built environment and infrastructure so our societies can be healthier. Technology is massive. How do you deploy technology, information systems to manage and measure things in ways that hasn't been done before? We have a global economy that moves so fast. You know, Britain is no longer the economic powerhouse it once was, although we're still number five. We have all sorts of competition and loads of people moving to cities. So how do we make those work well? The answer is you've got to have, and also you can't afford to get things wrong. The pace of change is so fast. And, you know, in our country, there isn't a lot of spare money around to get things wrong. So what's quite good for us is policy forming, business strategy forming, bets that are being taken, investments that are being made are increasingly based on evidence and evidence across a diverse system than how loud you speak and what your opinion is. And that's great for us. The trick for us is to find ways of drawing together our multidisciplinary research into tools and products that many people can use. One of the ways we showcase things, actually, at BRE in Watford is with our innovation park. So you're all very welcome to visit any time you like. But we basically build tomorrow's buildings today. Zero carbon, working for resilience for changing climate, working for old people. We open one on Friday, which is called Zero Bills. It's a very cost-effective way to build a home. And it's branded Zero Bills because if you build that home and live in that home, that's exactly what your energy bill would be. In fact, your energy bill might be positive because you generate more power than you consume. It's just incredible how far and how fast thinking is going. But we also have an array of other things. It's not just new build we look at, though. We look at existing buildings. This was a set of Victorian terraces that we've deployed, and we've retrofitted with all sorts of industry companies to try new ways of doing things, get it insulated. We've taken aerogels, which we use to insulate spacesuits for astronauts, and applied it in buildings because you get very good insulation performance in very thin ways. We've looked at all sorts of technologies here. And I'm rather pleased to be doing that, have done that, because now I'm doing this review for the government on how we make Britain's homes more energy efficient. You actually have an insight. Anyway, we do that, very industrially related. And then we have an array of products that are used widely. And the key here is bringing that diversity of thinking into very practical tools that people can use. Earlier on, I mentioned BREEAM that we used on the Olympic project, which brought together the disparate but related factors when you're designing a green building. Well, BREEAM is now currently being designed into 2 million buildings around the world. That's a huge impact. LPCB is loss prevention. That's all about life safety. The Academy is our two-year-old academy that we've put 20,000 people through last year to skill them up to do building information modelling or to apply sustainability. So the trick, and that's where you make your money. When you're running we're 1,000 people, net we turn over about £50 million. We make no money from doing science at all. It's hard to make any money. The way you make your money is by having a fee that nobody notices on a project many millions of times, and that adds up and allows you to stay in your business, invest in new science, and to grow. We catch the eye of all sorts of helpful people. Prime Minister came up looking very thoughtful. This was at the beginning of his first reign when he was trying to work out how to make the cabinet work and join things up. He came up on his own, no advisors, no other secretaries of state. And at the time I was working on the Olympics, and goodness, we had all these builders cooperating to build zero carbon homes. You know, how could that be? What was the formula? What was the recipe? And what might he learn by it? And the formula is very simple. You bring together diverse arrays of science. You enable a culture of people allowed to try and to innovate. And if you do that right, you learn by doing all the time, relentlessly improve. You're positive critical, not destructive critical. So you never make the same mistake twice. You build on success, and you never keep people in the head or make them feel small unless they've done something that's bullying or Machiavellian. And that's a way of making all sorts of things happen. This chap was very helpful. Here's the Premier of China. He came with a very nervous Vince Cable to see us. He came for 18 minutes, supposedly. I was told to speak to him and do my best to sell Britain. Because they spend lots of money on infrastructure. I was told he'd probably say for 8. He probably wouldn't acknowledge me, but I was to look at him dutifully and do it for Britain. That was my briefing. Anyway, he left 3 hours later because lots of things are going wrong in China based on a prescriptive way of telling people how to do things rather than a performance-based way. And the outcome of that is, in the last UK-China summit with Tsinghua University, we signed a £200 million cash research programme to make green cities work. We've been given about 500 acres of land in Guyana. We're building an innovation park out there. We're just prospering in that area because this guy Oh, and this guy also, not only does he want his infrastructure work, but he sees the might of the Chinese economy being based on having the world's best engineers and scientists, and he knows he can know them with us. That's where we operate now around the world. Our BREEAM standards, green and purple, are operating in 70 countries. Our life safety standards, red and purple, are in about 65 countries. Where it's purple, it's both of them. But don't get too excited. Russia looks very big on the map and very purple, but we've only done about 1,000 buildings there. So we've had almost no impact, and I'm not sure we want to keep doing business there. Whereas if you go to Europe, we have 80% of all green certified buildings. So we're gradually making our way. And behind it, who's best at engineering and designing and consulting on these types of buildings? Well, it's Brits. So the likes of Atkins, Arabs, Bureau Happold and others are exporting behind our standards. Another key element is the team. And so we're working in construction. What's the percentage of women in? It's about 5%.
It's low.
We're 40% in BRE. 40% women. We're about 20% non-English growing up people. So the recession, I know that's not a very eloquent way to describe them, is it? But the recession has been really helpful for us because it's drawn the best talent from Europe to Britain, to BRE, to work with us. Like in the First World War, we've got employment things. Of our 40% women, 32% are on part-time working, and they're more productive than when they were full-time. And our creche is full of, almost not quite full of, anyway, about half the babies in our creche have got a BRE brand on their forehead. Because like I met Dawn here, you get loads of young women and loads of young chaps together, and the inevitable happens and some of them get together and produce BRE babies. So we're investing in the next generation. And the other thing that's really exciting is I've just established an executive committee, so I've just brought through the next generation of people to succeed me, 7 people, 4 of whom are women. But nothing to do with any, it's not because they're women there, it's because they're bloody good and they're the best we've got. And we've just, because we've got that rich pool coming through now, that you have a choice and you can bring the very best through. So we've found ways, and maternity leave is brilliant because people leave work, somebody else comes in to do their job. You have the choice, unlike in the First World War where the maternity leave can go back to that job. But quite a few now. In fact, 2 on my executive committee are ladies I met on the first day back from maternity leave and promoted them into a much more ambitious job just because they'd been psychologically and emotionally freed up from what they did before. So, anyway, that's a bit about BRE. Now, we're going to look forward a bit, aren't we now, Dawn?
Mm-hmm.
Final furlong.
Yeah. So this is my last bit. So this last bit's about what we can do in the future, really. We probably don't all work in engineering, but one of the things that we can do as a society, I think, is around inclusivity. And by inclusivity, I mean making sure that the language that we use is inclusive language, making sure that where we have publications, they are showing a diverse range of people in the publications, conference proceedings, making sure we have men and women speakers. So inclusivity is the thing that, like health and safety and like ethics, is one of the building blocks of engineering, really. And I think what we have to get into the habit of doing is putting a lens over everything that we do. So just like when we do anything at all, we make sure it's safe. And you make sure it's ethical before you do it. You have to make sure it's inclusive as well. I think it's one of these umbrella competencies. And I think we have to start to teach that to our undergraduates as well. I'd really like to see some modules in our university degrees which teaches that inclusivity. And from an engineering point as well, the solutions that you can come up with if you have inclusive solutions are much better than those if you don't have that as one of your focuses. Should that be? Collaboration is the second one. So, there's so much activity in this area at the moment to try and encourage more diversity in engineering. I think if we collaborated more, we'd have much more chance of being successful. One of the ways I think that we could collaborate is on careers. I think we have a very striking lack of careers information for 16 to 18-year-olds. And I think that disproportionately disadvantages women who find it very difficult to choose engineering at that point of their career. So there's some great careers advice out there produced by all of the professional institutions, for example, lots of the companies. If we could get that together in one place and have some independent service of careers advice, I think that would be really helpful. Other ways as well, collaboration, you know, will help in all sorts of ways. And the third one, the final one really for me, is wondering, is it time to be more disruptive? I wrote a report last year for the ICE, the Institution of Civil Engineers, on disruptive diversity. And that's talking about what can we do to change things and stop the incremental growth and try and aim for more of a step change. So, for example, maybe it's time to think about financial incentivization for degrees that we actually need. So, you know, we're often wondering how we're going to get the attention of parents, but if you had a degree that was cheaper in engineering than in something else that the country doesn't necessarily need, then, you know, that's a really clear way of reaching those parents and students. Procurement contracts. Peter spoke earlier about the balanced scorecard and making sure that you've got other factors when you're giving public money out, for example. You know, we have lots of big infrastructure contracts. Why don't we write in diversity and inclusion into these contracts and drive the behaviours that we want to see? It's the same with Athena Swan as well. Athena Swan is the charter for gender diversity at university level. Now, the Medical Research Council mandates that it will only give money to universities who have Athena Swan bronze. But the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council doesn't do that. You know, and if they did that tonight, we would have a step change tomorrow. You know, all of engineering departments would have to think about what they did for diversity and inclusion. Quotas is very,
contentious.
Contentious, thank you. But I mean, is it time for quotas? Is it time for the threat of quotas? Or put another way, you know, do we need targets that we can achieve? I think we need to start thinking about how we do make sure that we are getting the behaviours that we want. Even if we had targets for the equal number of men and women for job shortlists, then that's one way of making sure that companies actually go out and try to make sure that they're looking in the right places for people to fill their new roles. Accreditation is another way that we can get into the universities and make sure the universities are doing the right things. When we go and see other universities to accredit them, professional institutions have a role there where they can create best practice and pass that on. So, you know, I'm sure there are things that we can do to get the behaviours that we want, and I think maybe it's time that we started to be more disruptive. Thank you.
Okay. And then just also how we apply this diverse thinking. These pictures here represent these independent reviews I've somehow or other been asked to do for the government. Grown in Britain is one I did on woodlands and forests, which is about how we get more money, more economic vibrancy to create a more economically sustainable wood industry and forest industry, and how we get more people more active. The one with strawberries on from a farm in Devon is the one I did on food procurement. This was for all our schools, hospitals, prisoners and others. The one I'm doing at the moment is this one on housing energy efficiency. Anyway, the point about all of them is fixing them is a lot about diversity. So if we take the food one, what we did there was, first thing is you engage a diverse audience. You engage headmistresses, hospital trust CEOs, farmers, caterers, government procurement people, the myriad of logisticians, the myriad of diverse groups that need to think as a collective to address a common cause. The second thing you do is, so there's a diversity in the people involved, the organisations involved. The second thing you do is we built, just like I learned on the Olympics to buy by a balanced scorecard, I led on construction products for the Olympics as well. We did the same thing for food and farming. Because if you just buy, if you have austerity going mad, if you want horse meat where it should be beef, and if you want to serve food that's so disgusting to hospital patients that 40% of it goes in the bin, just buy the cheapest and force an industry to buy the cheapest, and that's the outcome you get. If you ask an industry to innovate to get a balance between quality and cost, They come up with all sorts of things, like cutting out loads of margin taking middlemen and going straight to the farmer and paying them more for seasonal, variable, tasty foods. And what we've proved all around the country is we're paying less money for much better quality and tasty food, and those waste levels and things have gone down. Just last week or the week before, the Secretary of State for the Environment, Liz Truss, went to the bear pit of the National Farmers Union Conference to announce a new £500 million of money that's being spent feeding prisoners through this balanced scorecard. You know, there's been all this controversy about dairy industry and farmers not getting enough money for their milk. Well, Bidvest bid for supplying 30 million cartons a year to prisoners, sourced from British farmer, cutting out all sorts of middle people. The outcome is dairy farmers are getting paid what they're due and they're making proper profit. The prisoners get tasty milk, which you may or not care for. The government's doing an ailing role in the middle, and an innovative British company has found a way of making it work. So you get great cost outcome and quality together. This housing review I'm doing at the moment, a similar thing. There are an array of factors, a system, diverse system, which if you bring together will fix these quite serious problems and create opportunities around smart homes and how we make those things work more efficiently. So the point is, however, whatever, I brought those up because, you know, what we're talking about applies to the Olympic Games, it applies to women in science and engineering, it applies to food, it can apply to forestry, it can apply anywhere. And if we all think about bringing together diverse organisations, diversity in people and diversity in thinking, then we can achieve all sorts of outcomes. So we'll finish by saying huge hurrah for the University of Bath as it approaches the 25th of October this year. Many congratulations on all that's been done. We are both enormously grateful and indebted, aren't we, to the university.
Yeah.
And it's a real honour to have been part of it. And thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
After such a diverse presentation, I am sure that there will be questions. Who wants to? Oh, Professor Davenport.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor. In spirit of diversity, I won't ask a question at all. I'll just say something.
Okay,
I represent the British Computer Society on the Athena Forum. And last time I met the Chief Executive of EPSRC in January, I asked him precisely the question Dawn asked, which is, why doesn't EPSRC do what MRC does? And the answer is the Equality Challenge Unit have said they aren't staffed to do it.
Uh-huh.
So what we actually need is disruption at that level.
Mm. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, gentleman at the back.
Hi, Garrett Musto, on behalf of the Institute of Mathematics. I'm a local teacher. I work with the Royal Academy of Engineering, and I'm also the diversity champion of the IMA. Can I just say what an inspirational talk, and maybe I'd love to get your details to maybe try and work more closely with you with regards to some of your diversity work within the Royal Academy of Engineering. But that was absolutely inspirational. Thank you very, very much.
Okay.
I am absolutely certain that at some point we will get a question. Yes, is it a question?
It is a question.
Jolly good.
My name is Alan Yams. I'm married to a professional engineer who's also a member of the Royal Academy. But I have a question for Dawn, really. I train as a material scientist, but I'm very aware that certain of our professional bodies are very much very traditional in their approach, not very diverse in their thinking, not very equal in their thinking about people, sexes. I wondered, how do you encourage some of our professional institutions to be more diverse in their thinking, really? And are there institutions which are already doing that, have very good practice, which you could try to encourage others to follow?
Mm. Yeah, well, we're both part of the Institute of Materials, Minerals and Mining, and I sit on their Women in Materials Committee with Irene Turner from the University of Bath, or one of our lecturers from that isn't here tonight, I don't think, is she? But, So we recognise that we do need to do something more in that institution, and we are trying, but it's not very easy in some of the institutions. In others, there's definitely more of an acknowledgement that we do have to do something. The Institution of Engineering and Technology, we have the first woman president here tonight, Naomi Glimmer. They are really progressive in this regard. They have a young woman engineer competition and have done for the last 40 years. The Royal Academy have a diversity concordat, which gets all of the professional institutions together to get them to share best practice. And I think that's working out really well. I lead one of their programs called Return, and that's about trying to get women who, often if a woman has left their career, the professional institution is the last place that will have that person's details. If they've left their professional institution as well, then you have to go back to the alumni department of their university. So professional institutions do have a role of looking after those women during their career breaks, and that's what I'm working on with a group of institutions at the moment. But yeah, there's just lots to do, and some are better than others, and we've just got to keep on encouraging them.
And in IET as well, if I might add, I dutifully support the president as a trustee there. But one of the little things we've just done, we've done a big thing, which is vote through some governance changes. But we also had something where we tied it up all in all our bylaws. We use gender-neutral terms in every part of all our documentation. And, you know, that's quite a significant step, and it just helps everywhere start engendering this equality way of thinking. So there's a lot to do, there's a lot more to do, isn't there? But I think the institutions, most of them, not all of them, are trying to work out how to improve this thing.
Yes, gentlemen here at the front. Just a second for the microphone. A bit further down, please, Mark.
Thank you. Barry Brooks, a past president of the IET and enjoying 2 days here in Bath with the current president, Naomi, who was mentioned, and friends, obviously, of our speakers through the IET and Wes. Dawn, I really like the idea of the return ships, and I just wonder whether that is gathering momentum and what else we collectively could do to help.
I think it is gathering momentum. It's an easy solution, really, because there's nothing that needs to change from what's already being offered as an internship. And the good thing about them is it gives a stepping stone for women who maybe don't want to go back into the career at the level they were at before, and they've got maybe a young family and they don't want that responsibility. So it's, I think it's a really good model of getting women back in. So I think it is gathering momentum. I think we saw only one, Thames Tideway, last year. I think we've got maybe two or three this year, Carillion, Thames Tideway again. They're in the construction sector, but yeah, it's just spreading the word, I think. And it's unfortunately a term that is trademarked, I think, by Goldman Sachs. So I don't think they mind people using it, but I use it liberally. But I think it is. So we're just trying to spread that.
And the thing
message.
Too for us here, so if you're into returnships, you might not. It depends with you where you are in terms of hierarchy, but I've heard about returnships. So in BRE now we're offering 10. We can do an experiment now and see if we can find 10 experienced women who've been on a career break for 5 years or so to come and work with our organisation. They won't all make it probably. You know, they won't all be employed by us, but I bet they try really hard. I bet they're really productive for us, and I bet a number come and work with us, and it'll be a real benefit to our company. So us here, you know, I'm a chap that runs a company who has a chance to do this, but I bet quite a few of us here could bring in one or two or three and see how it goes. And then you actually create outcomes, don't you?
Yeah.
Bas Franke, Head of Department of Psychology. Thank you, first of all, for your inspirational presentations. Are you agreeing with me that what I believe is the core value of your approach and also of the success and the power of diversity, it seems to me that it is trust in who you work with. And as soon as you don't have fundamental deep trust in the qualities and the good human nature of your colleagues, you have to rely on rules and power to get things done, and then you end up with a brutal organization. Is trust, in your opinion, do you agree that that's a key in the success and power of diversity?
Are you asking both of us?
Actually,
me?
Yes.
Because, okay,
yes,
well,
I would like to...
Do you want to go first?
No, yeah.
Okay, so but this is a critical factor. The Olympics was successful not only because of systems and processes and procedure. It was mainly successful because of psychology, attitude, culture of the people working on the park. And it was absolutely palpable, and it's why we did well. Everybody's voice counts. Everybody had a view which was listened to. You had a culture where you're allowed to fail, providing it was by good intent. And it was everywhere. When we had these very gaudy big pins that we all had to wear as bosses in the Olympics in the beginning. You remember the logo, and they were pink, orange, green, or blue. I know I'm wearing an orange one now, but we're 2016 now, and it's quite small. These were big. Anyway, we all had to wear them as suits. The boss ones, we were given them. And about a week after we were issued them, we saw them selling on eBay for £100 or £150. And do you know who was buying them? It was the Gurkhas who were working for G4S and security, because they were so proud to be working on the Olympics that they were buying the pins. So we couldn't have that, so we free-issued them. And then we free-issued, when we had 1 million hours without a portable accident, we gave them a special pin. When we did a year, we gave them a pin. When we got green outcomes, we had a special sustainability pin. And it was just that little psychological, motivational permission to be great rather than being dictated to and beaten down that made all the difference. In BRE, it's like that with our customers. On my reviews I've done, you know, we have quite a lot of power, but you rely on people to be up for. It's hugely about psychology and culture. And that's how we engineers and scientists need to think much more about how we become successful, much less focused on the problems and the technical solutions and the regulations, and much more how we motivate people, and also how we get round pegs in round holes and square pegs in square holes. Well, I know you're. I'm preaching to you. I don't mean to do that. You're the expert. I'm not. But it's all about that. Thank you.
Yeah. Do you want to add anything, Dawn?
No.
Okay. Good. I think that there's. Peter, you've got a question, haven't you?
Yeah. I've got a quick question. I'm Peter Ford. I was at the physics department here. I went to the Institute of Physics. The physics community has the Daphne Jackson Fellowships, which are designed for ladies returning to physics after career break, mainly to have raise a family. Daphne Jackson was the first female professor of physics in this country, who sadly died rather young, I think at the age of 50, from cancer. But does the engineering fraternity have something similar?
Can I just interject slightly? I was the chair of the Daphne Jackson Trust for 5 years. And it's not only in physics that the Daphne Jackson Trust supports returners. It's actually across the piece. So all sciences and into engineering now. There is that going on. Daphne. I worked with Daphne. It was in her honour. But it's gone way beyond that now. It's very large.
Daphne Jackson was a past president of the Women's Engineering Society as well.
Yeah.
So
we do know about it, Peter. Okay. Is there one more question? Yes. Gentleman over there on the side.
The word engineer is probably the most abused word in the English language. The man who comes and mends your washing machine is not an engineer, and the classic way of seeing an engineer is someone with a spanner and an oil can in their hand. And Dawn, in your opinion, how can we enhance the engineering to make it attractive? Because it's probably a incentive to a lot of schoolgirls who see people with dirty overalls on and doing a dirty job.
I agree. I mean, we have debates about this, don't we?
No, yeah. We're going to do a double story here. You can tell one bit. I'll tell you what you've done in a minute.
I absolutely agree. I was on the tube train a couple of weeks ago, and there was a couple next to me, a mom and her daughter. And an announcement, the daughter was about 10, 9 or 10, and an announcement came over the tannoy that said that the escalator was broken. The escalator was broken, and they couldn't get out of the thing, and that was due to engineering works. And the daughter said to the mum, "Well, mummy, what's engineering?" And she said, "Oh, that's fixing the escalator." And I thought, so immediately, right there, right then, that girl thinks, so, you know, engineering's not for me, I don't want to do engineering. So I think it is a big issue, and I think in the industry we don't realise the damage we're doing to young people. I go out all the time to schools, and you know that is absolutely the thing. They just don't know what engineering is, and it's just, as you say, such a broad profession. I don't quite know what we can do about that, but
I do. I know what you do. You know the disruption term that Dawn said, be a bit disruptive. So do you know what she did? She wrote to the boss of Network Rail. Didn't you? Mm. To say, will you stop describing maintenance work as engineering? Anyway, she was referred to, who was it? The operations director.
Mm.
Anyway, do you know what they're going to do? They're going to refer to, you know when you're on the station and they're saying they're engineering works? No longer. So through Dawn and her disruption, because she's like not prepared to accept these things, the boss of, is it Network Rail?
Yeah.
The boss of Network Rail is now going to describe maintenance works as maintenance works and not engineering works.
But the trouble is they do some amazing engineering works on the railways. And if only they would tell people what... You know, people want to know what engineering works is going on so that they can be excited about that. But actually where it is maintenance, then it's maintenance. And, you know, we have to be clear and we have to be proud of when we are doing engineering work and describe it by what it is. You know, girls need to know that one thing is civil engineering and one thing is systems engineering. You know, so stop describing everything good that happens as being done by a scientist and every problem that's being, you know, addressed as being done by an engineer. So we need to get, it's a different way of thinking of engineering and trying to link it to being the solving of problem or the creating of solutions rather than the solving of problems all the time. So it's a, yes, I agree with you.
I think on that optimistic note, we should stop the questions. Falls to me to propose a vote of thanks to our speakers this evening. And I have to say that I consider it rare indeed to have a husband and wife team who can enthrall us with the degree of knowledge and impact that this pair have done tonight. But then I should not be surprised, should I, really? Because this was a match made at this university. I dare say you all know that one in four marriages or partnership that people first have in their lives, actually, if they're graduates, start in their universities. So it's not exactly unusual that a university should be a matchmaker. What is unusual is that it should make such a match. And I really do think it's wonderful. I think also what we've seen this evening is characteristic of graduates of this university. What we've seen is two people who are really into the business of changing the world for everybody else. And that's what so many of our graduates go on to do. And I am proud of that. I am more proud of our speakers this evening because they are quite clearly fearless advocates of what they think should be changed. And that, again, is a really rare combination, to know what needs to be changed and to have that courage to bring it about. So I really do think that it's fantastic that we've got these people doing what they're doing. I think it's even more fantastic that in two completely different ways, they are still supporting this university. Our Department of Civil Engineering, Architecture and Civil Engineering would not be the same without its partnership with you and with Bree.
We're very pleased to be associated.
And I have to say that the work that's now being done with Wes and with the students is just fantastic. Mm. And I also want to say that it's important, the small, relatively small donation, relative because they've given the university an enormous amount of money, that the Warrods actually gave to enable that to happen was life-changing for a lot of the girls that are going through the process, and it will carry on. Mm. And having members of this university, because of course Roger Warrod is also a graduate of this university, investing in the future of our graduates is so terribly important. So in all possible ways, thank you this evening, but more importantly, thank you for everything you have done over many years for this university.
Thank you.